wrote something down as I was preparing, and it came after I had already printed my message. But you stand today in the power of Christ. So you're not standing in your own power, you're standing in His power. And everything He has for you to do will get done. He's got a duty for each one of us. He's got a call on each one of us. And He's got a way to work out those situations. Amen? Praise God. All right. I want to take you to 2 Corinthians chapter 9 today. 6 through 15. And before I start reading that, I want to hold up something to you. Anybody recognize what that is?
Checkbook.
But it has no checks in it. But now it has a register. And the register says, never no deposits made. So the balance in this checkbook is zero. The point that I'm trying to make is if you don't put something in the checking account, you don't have anything to spend. Amen? You get that? No deposits, no withdrawals. Amen? So, where I'm taking you today is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 through 15. But this is such an important piece of Scripture. And I want to say it has nothing to do with tithing, but it has to do with the balance of your life. And it has to do with what God wants to bring about for you. And Paul tells you something at the very beginning that is just like this checkbook. In verse 6 he says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. So if you don't put anything in it, you won't get anything out of it. That's what he's telling you. And as we go through the rest of this chapter, if you're not willing to be a blessing to God, who will you be a blessing to? And if God has saved your life and given you a new spirit, a new lease on life, then who else would take care of you the way God does except God? Now, and I'm going to skip because I read you verse 6. But this I say, he who soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. But there's something that I want you to see in verse 14. And by their prayers for you. So we're going to fill in these other scriptures. We're going to go through 7 through 13. And then use some others. But if you don't get into the mood of letting God balance your life, if you won't change your lifestyle to be what God wants it to be, then you will never get to verse 14. Because if you're running your own race, then that's all you're going to have is your own race. I was watching a movie the other day, and questions. But this guy, he told a young man that he was trying to kill. And he said, you saved my son's life, so I'm going to free your life, and I'm going to kill you. And if you grant me that, I'll gladly go to hell. And that was his wording. And the young guy granted it to him. And he turned around and left him alone and left. And that was near the end of the show. But there's something going on here in this chapter, in this piece of this chapter. And in verse 14, he says, and by their prayers to you, which long after you, for the exceeding grace of God in you. So the exceeding grace of God is already in you. But if you determine in your life to spare God, and you don't want to be rich towards him, then I don't think you're ever going to get to verse 14, because the people you're supposed to help, you would never have helped them, because you're busy hoarding it all to yourself, or just being poor, or just not having anything, or you just don't have time for God, you don't have time for the Bible. All those situations are in here. Okay, now I want to start back up again and go to verse 7. Remember, the exceeding grace is already in you. In other words, when I got born again, I had exceeding grace already in me. I just didn't know it. And I didn't know the scriptures. And I still don't know very much. But the exceeding grace, I'm finding out, it's already in them. And as I do what God's asking me to do, and as I give and I bring balance to my life the way he wants me to, I get more and more into this exceeding grace. And another word for the grace is favor. So if you're going to find the favor of God, it won't do for you to be spared in any part of your life. I don't think this is only talking about money. I think it's talking about every situation that you get into, God wants to be in it. And he wants to be a part of it. And he has determined some things. Paul is seeing something by revelation here. Number one, if you're going to be sparing, don't consider even being in the grace of God. Don't expect any favor from Almighty God, although he'll probably give you some anyway. Because he's a loving God. Now verse 7, every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Man. Well, you don't only give money.
That's right.
If this was all about money, then okay, let's preach about money. And give me everything you got. You know, or like Brother Hagin used to do, he'd especially get the women, and he'd say, now, ladies, stand up and get your little change purse out of your purse, and I want you just to take all the change out of there and just throw it up in the air and give it to God. And then all the ladies, you know, and you got sometimes 18,000 people sitting in there, and all the ladies would throw their money up in the air. He said, don't worry about it, we'll collect it later. But you know, out of all your change, that could end up being a lot of money, couldn't it? Amen. And somebody had to clean all that up and pick it all up later on. But can you purpose in your heart to serve God who saved you? Can you purpose in your heart to serve God who loves you? Can you purpose in your heart to serve the one that forgave all your sins? He debt of your sins, my sins, our sins, into his body. And God turned around and put him into your body. That's the exchange. Come on, just stop and think about it. Everything that I'd been doing wrong, Jesus became. And everything that he'd been doing right, I became. That's why the exceeding grace is already there. We just don't know it. And God was hiding this revelation about grace until, what, maybe 10 years ago? Hello? But all of a sudden, he just said, it's time. It's time. And some of the people who were carrying the grace message got out of kilter. And that's not unusual. We did the same thing with the faith message, and we've done the same thing with everything else. And God's going to bring it back where it's in the middle where it belongs. God loves the cheerful giver. Well, Linda and I were in Tulsa, Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. And this was 1998. And we had not been out there since 1978. So it was 20 years. We went to Kenneth Hagin's camp meeting. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, now, Happy Fowler was up there preaching. And he said, go up there and lay some money on the altar. And now this is camp meeting. Imagine how many people are there. And he said, plant a seed. Put some money out there. And take the limits off of my glory. Well, I never heard anything like that before. I hadn't even studied about the glory. So I told Linda what he said, and she says, well, do it. And I said, well, God, how much should I put up there? You know what he answered me? He said, as you purpose in your heart. Hello? So God is working with us to purpose in our heart. To do something for him. Do something with him. So I turned around and I took some money out of my billfold. I started walking up there and there were people coming from all over to lay money on the altar. And Happy Caldwell's preaching, I don't remember the message, but, you know, he's a pretty good preacher. And he had a church, I think, in, anyway, I don't know where it was. But anyway, verse 8 says, God is able to make all grace abound toward you. God is able. You know, we got that up there. And it's been up there ever since this church started, somewhere around 1980. But God is able to take care of you. And that's the message that God's trying to get across to us. And Paul is writing these things to the church in Corinth, that God wants to take care of you. God is able to take care of everything about your life. So this has not got to do with just money. This has got to do with your love towards other people. This has got to do with your love and your faith connecting together. And God says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. So this has got to be a connection between you and your God. Between you and God the Father. Between you and Jesus. And between you and the Holy Spirit that's come to live in you forever. And he's not going to leave you. He's going to keep trying to teach you. And he's going to keep working on you. Well, does all he wants you to do is give money? No. He wants you to change in every area of your life. I walked out of the doctor's office last Thursday and I looked down and there's a $5 bill give it to the nurse. I said, wait a minute, she won't know what to do with it either. So I took it and I put it up on my visor. And I thought, okay, when the Lord's ready, he'll show me what to do with that. So I got up the road here, and there was an older gentleman on the side of the road. And I just happened to look at him, and I looked up, and I said, oh, that's what I'm doing. And I just felt like the Lord was saying down in here, give it to him. So I waved it like that, and he came over to the car. I let the window down and gave him the $5 bill. You know, I think that's the way the Lord works with us. You know, I had a lady one time. We were working at her house, hanging wallpaper and painting. And I was talking to my guys, and we'd been talking about me going to Russia again. And we got there the next day, and she's waiting at the door on me. And she says, look, look, look. I said, she said, I went out walking last night, and an angel blew this $20 bill up under my feet. And I knew I had to give it to you. To go to Russia. So, you know, God's working, isn't he? God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having how much sufficiency? All sufficiency. See, he's not talking about one subject. He's talking about everything. But the end result is going to be that there's people waiting on you to come, and the exceeding grace that's in you is going to be poured out on them. Because of the favor that God is going to multiply and bring back to you. Boy, if I can get that across to you. If you could just see yourself with this exceeding grace. All right, now let's take a minute and think about one of these times when the Lord spoke to me in this place. The lady came, and she was a new Christian. And God said, I want you to call her up and pray for her. I'm going to give her a new liver. So later on, when we're in Russia, he said, call them up. There's people in here that need a touch on their liver. They need a new liver. So there were 10 people came up, and 7 of them called back the next day and said they were totally healed. The other 3, we just never heard from. Okay? Now that was a word of knowledge. So can you imagine the exceeding grace of God working in your life, and God gives you a word of knowledge for 100,000 people? Because that word exceeding has no end to it. I mean, if you look at Abraham's blessing in Genesis chapter 15, he said, I am your exceeding great reward. God put that in there, not Abraham. Abraham's out in the middle of a place, he don't even know where he is, and he's living in a tent, but he has obeyed God, and he's got no Bible, he's got nothing except God's appearance, and God's coming after him, and God's speaking to him in the nighttime, or in the daytime. Or God just showing up with a couple of angels around him, talking to him about Sodom and Gomorrah and how he's going to destroy it. Come on. And Abraham has the guts, the courage to go up to God, walk with him and say, if there's 50 people there, will you still destroy it? If there's 50 righteous, will the God of heaven not do what's right? And he goes all the way down to 10. And he says, God, don't get angry with me, but let me speak one more time. If there's 10 there, and God intervenes and says, if there's 10 people there, I won't destroy Sodom anymore that are righteous. Now, Abraham's learning how to walk with God, and it's affecting everything about his life, not just money. It's bringing balance to him. That's what God's trying to do with us. is bring us into some balance, discipline. In my case, I had to wake up and hear that word from him one morning. Discipline. Because I didn't have any balance. Come on, I'm talking about me as a child, me as an individual. Now, I could sit and eat a whole tub of ice cream. Or I could sit and eat a whole bag of licorice, candy. When we couldn't find any candy, we'd go get the sugar bowl, take a little bit of sugar, just to get sugar. See, there wasn't any balance. Hello. Come on, this has got to do with grace and it's got to do with favor, but it's also got to do with the exceeding grace that's already in you. And that's what you've got to see out of these scriptures. And I've got to keep going or I won't get through it. All sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Now, you are a good work looking for somewhere to go for Almighty God. You're the good work. It's not your neighbor. It's not somebody else. You're the good work. We are the good work. And I can't stop there. Stop there. But that's a separate message altogether. You're finding out that in Psalm 92, it says God is blessing me with good work. And I will triumph in the work of thy hands, O Lord. And I say that to him all the time. I'm not looking for another meeting. I'm not looking for what I want. I'm looking to do what you want. And I'm looking to triumph in the work of your hands. Because that's what Jesus was doing, was the work of God. Praise God. See, as it is written, he has dispersed abroad. He has given to the poor. His righteousness remaineth forever. You've been made the righteousness of God. When Jesus took your sin, he became sin for you, that you might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. In Christ, you are his righteousness. That is never going to leave you. The exceeding grace of God that God was talking about to Abraham. He said, Abraham, I'm going to make you a mighty nation. And your seed is going to be like the sand of the seashore and like the stars in the sky. Well, Abraham is still, he's moved from the center of the earth to heaven. And he's up there in heaven. And his seed is still being produced on the earth because yesterday somebody got born again. And today maybe somebody will get born again. And they become the seed of Abraham. And it's not about seeds, it's about the seed of Abraham. But God made a promise to him and he never backed off of Abraham. He never went and found somebody else when Abraham missed him. He never goes and finds somebody else when you miss it. I miss it. Or we do something wrong. He's not looking to correct that way. He's correcting us in love. And he's correcting us by showing us the truth of what's in his word. We become the righteousness of God forever. Hello? Still here?
Yes.
Now watch verse 10. Now he that ministereth seed to the sower, both ministereth bread for your food, and multiplies your seed sown and increases the fruit thereof. Now he's multiplying your seed sown. You walk by and you smile at somebody. They used to say there's a lot of smile takes less muscles than a frown. So an angry face is harder. It uses more of your muscles and more of your energy than the smile does. Smile, right? Amen? And you may think that, well, that's not seed. Tell me it's not. When that girl's having a hard time, and she's behind the register, and you walk up and smile at her and say something nice, you change the whole atmosphere around you. And you change her. Increase the fruit. Now, Psalm 92, it talks about even when I'm old, I'll still bear fruit. Well, I'm not old yet, but I'm getting there. But I'm bearing fruit. And my fruit shall remain. Hello?
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
See what he's talking about here? How are you going to balance your life with God Almighty God? You've got to be in all of these things. Multiply the seed sown and increase the fruit of your righteousness. Both of these are stopped if you don't qualify. Now look at Galatians chapter 5. And I'm going to have to come back to 2 Corinthians. Galatians 5:19. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. And it's got a whole list for two or three verses of the different things that are the works of the flesh. That's what you're trying to stop in your life. Because the works of the flesh won't get you into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I said the works of the flesh won't get you into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
But you've got flesh. And you miss it sometimes. Hello? So there's still a need for asking forgiveness for sin.
Amen.
Because the works of the flesh are just that, they're sin. Doesn't matter if it's adultery, or just anger, or violence. Doesn't matter. It's still the works of the flesh. So we're trying to change the works of the flesh and bring it under balance. We're trying to make it slim and none. But we're trying to also increase the balance of God in our life. Not live a sparing life, not live just for ourselves, but live for God. Amen? You still with me?
Yes.
All right. Now, that was Galatians 5:19. And there's another message there. The works of the flesh needs to be taught about sometime. That's probably the week you need to take vacation or something. And not even be here, but the works of the flesh, there's some words in there, I don't even know what they mean. Okay? And a lot of the commentators, they just believe that's lost people. But no, I still got some works for the flesh. And I'm not lost. I belong to Jesus.
Amen.
Put on Christ this morning. You see what we're talking about?
Amen.
But this is that sparing life. This is what needs to become sparing in my life.
Yeah.
This is what I got to put under and stop doing. I don't need to eat the whole bag of Tootsie Rolls. I I don't need that much sugar at one time. Neither do you. Okay. I meddled enough. Now, verse 11. Being enriched in everything to all bountifulness. That's another word for exceeding. So I'm going to be enriched by what God is doing, and He's bringing increase. He's sowing more seed in my life, and He's bringing increase. He's multiplying my seed sown, in verse 10, and He's increasing the fruit of my righteousness. Both of those things are coming at the same time. Why? Because I gave Him a little money? Yeah. Because I loved on somebody? Yeah. Because I'm working and willing to do and praying? Yeah. And I'm doing what God's asking me to do? And I'm not fulfilling the works of the flesh? Yes. Because I don't want to keep myself out of the kingdom of God. Hello? I want to be part of the kingdom of God. Now, I think it was Friday night, we had a phone call, and it was somebody needed help over the phone. Well, it wasn't one of my best times, but it had to be taken care of right then. So God knew what to say anyway, and God knew how to deliver that person. And the truth is still in me. So it came up once I started depending on it. Hello. And that person, people talk about suicide in strange ways sometimes.
Amen.
But they're still trying to take their life to get out of what they're supposed to be in. Mm-hmm. And Satan's trying to talk them out of missing the kingdom of God sometimes, Hello. Okay. So He's multiplying your seed sown, and He's increasing the fruit of your righteousness. One of them is just as important as the other, because it's going to bring out the exceeding grace that's in you. All right. Praise God. You're getting enriched. You're getting into the exceeding part of your ministry, which causes thanksgiving to God. I had somebody in the car the other day, and I pulled out some money to give him a little bit of money. And, thank you. And there's no telling what they said later to come out. Hello? But they turn around and they give thanksgiving to God. And maybe, just maybe, they took part of that money and gave some of it back to God in the church. Listen, if you start living the way God wants you to live, you won't do without anything. I don't know how he does it, because when we started, there were a lot of short places. I remember one of them so vivid. We made a budget, and there were some places in the budget that we couldn't reach. And I went to the Lord and I said, Lord, I can't reach that part of my budget. I don't have enough funds. But every month, for 12 months, he put it in my budget. The work that I was doing, he just made enough work so that that was left over.
Man.
Well, it wasn't left over. But it was good to have those leftovers. Hello? He's got a way of taking care of you, and he's already got people set up to take care of you. Hallelujah. Now, verse 12. For the administration of this service not only supplieth the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgivings to God. So you become the administrator of what you're doing with God. And he's producing out of you not only to take care of others, but he's taking care of him, because they turn around and they give much thanks unto God. Go to a country that doesn't have hot water running, and then see how much time you spend thanking God for hot water running. Go to a country that doesn't even have a faucet for you to brush your teeth, or a sink for you to spit in, you know, and then you come back home, and you got all these facilities all around you. Mm-hmm. Or go to a country where you lose 10 pounds while you're there, because there's no good food to eat. And the lady in charge of you thinks enough of you not to give you just some roast dog, or something that, you know, they did have to be one time in Turkey. I asked her, I said, what kind of meat is this? She says, oh, it's some kind of meat. That was the only answer she could give me. I said, okay, if she's going to eat it, I'll eat it. And I said that to myself. But she dug in, so I dug in. I gave thanks to God anyway. Hello? And then you go to a country where you know, you get some fish that's bad, and the lady, the interpreter, goes to the pharmacy, and they give her some pieces of coal. I said, what? She says, eat it. It's good for your stomach. It'll stop what's going on. I didn't know that. I didn't know coal did that. Mm-hmm. Someone is shaking your head. So I ate them, two or three of those pieces, and I said, okay, this better work, you know, to myself. And they got rid of the diarrhea and all the upset stomach and all of that, eating cold. But it wasn't even processed into a pill, it was just pieces of coal like out of a coal mine, you know? But that's a pharmacy in a foreign country. Hello? Sometimes we don't realize how good we got it. For the administration of this service not only supplies the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgivings unto God. Verse 13. 2 Corinthians 9:13. While by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your professed subjection unto the gospel of Christ, and for your liberal distribution unto them and unto all men. And liberal is a mark of generosity, and it's having an open hand. When you see a need, you know, I got a person that shared this with me, and he was waiting in line to pay for his insurance, his car insurance. And the lady in front of him was a couple of $100 short. And so she said, he heard the person taking care of her. And he said, the person taking care of her said, well, you got to have $200 more. And she said, well, I don't have that kind of money. And he heard that conversation going on, and he said, excuse me, I'll take care of that for you. And he just handed the lady behind the counter $200. Just pay for her. Yeah, she couldn't believe what was going on. Who are you? You know, you're paying pay my insurance. Hello? But later he found out she was Christian and on and on and on. And she didn't know anything about that. Do you see, this is open-handedness. This is what you're doing. Sometimes it's just a prayer. Sometimes it doesn't mean you're reaching into your wallet. It could be the wrong thing sometimes. But you know what this does? It stops the beggar. Jesus went to the man that was born blind. And he said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. He put his anointing on his eyes, which is mud. Go wash in the pool. And when he came back, he could see. And there was never a man born blind that had been prayed for who could get new eyes and see. He got to create a miracle for that man. And he said that God's glory might do something for him. Hello. That's an exceeding grace. That's the part of grace that God wants to use in each one of us. And that's the favor of God that God wants you to be into. Doesn't matter if it's financing. Doesn't matter if it's just loving on somebody that needs some love. And Proverbs says the answer to an angry man is the kindness that you show, the gentleness. Not getting angry at him again. Anger doesn't pay for anger. See what we're talking about? Alright, let me go on and finish this now. Liberal was the mark of generosity. It's the open-handedness. This is Christ leading you in your giving and in what he's wanting out of you. So you've got to be open to the Lord to hear him and say, Lord, what do you want in this situation? Okay, now we get down to 14. And by that purpose for you, which long after you, for the exceeding grace of God in you, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. That's Jesus. That's Christ. But there's an unspeakable gift in you called the exceeding grace of God. That means that grace is there forever, and forever you'll be able to use it, and it has no limits to it. Come on. Some people want to go back to the Old Testament and teach about Elijah and Elisha and talk about a double anointing. You have got unlimited anointing for you through this exceeding grace of God. Now, I've stayed away from this as long as I can, but I want you to go over with me into Ephesians chapter 2. And I'm plugging this in so I don't have it in front of me. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. And raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Who's that talking about? That's talking about us being seated already in heavenly places. What was God's promise to Abraham? That I will make you a mighty nation. I will make you see like the stars in the heavens and like the sand on the earth, sand on the seashore. You know what Fred Price used to say about that? He said, if you want to see what eternity looks like, he said, you take one grain of sand and you walk from Florida all the way to California. And you put that piece of sand on the beach and you walk back and get another one. And you just be starting to get into eternity. And God told Abraham, he says, go outside and count the stars. That's the way your seed's going to be. And of course, if you ever tried to count all the stars, I don't think you could do that. But God's big enough, he named them all. The span of his hand was working to put the stars out there. Do you see what we're talking about here? Right. And then when you get into verse 14, and this becomes a lifestyle, now he's talking about you, and I want to go into Ephesians. Go back to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 and 7. All right, go to verse 7. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Now go back to 6 and 7 together. Can you do that? Can you get them up there? And raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now do 7. That in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Now, what's he going to show? What does he want to be kind with? The exceeding riches of his grace. The exceeding riches of his favor. The exceeding riches of the way you've been living your life. The exceeding riches of what you're doing. You know what he told me the other day? He said, it's time. It's time for the exceeding riches of God to be poured out. So it's time for God to bring his kindness to us and pour out his exceeding riches like it's never been poured out before. It's been stored up in you. It's been in there. Now, we had 10 people get a new liver. You know what God told me? He says, next time when I put you in front of a group, I'm going to give you 100 people and they're all going to get a new liver at one time. And that's not the end of this thing. Come on, we had a lady get a new spine in Russia. Nine grand disc, he just gave her a new spine. He didn't even mess with it. He did this. And I've seen her for 3 years. She's got no more pain in her spine, perfectly healed. When the Lord went with me as the bright morning star, hello, he had me doing this, and I threw the light at a lady sitting at the end of the row with the traces on, and she fell down 4 times, and she got back up. And the next morning she came back and she had no problems with her arm, it was turning blue, her back was totally straight, and her heart was beating right. And I've seen her for over 5 years, and she's still got that miracle in her body. Nobody ever touched her, just me flinging the frisbee on her. You know, the light. The greatness of God has come to us in samples. Now is the time. Now, something else I've got to do. And I'm going to get some of you in a class because God has even given me names. He's showed me 12 leaders in Russian who have to come be under my teaching when I go this time and be in class. And they're all going to come into this exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. They're going to be partakers of that exceeding riches, the kindness, and they're going to pour out the glory of Almighty God on their churches. They're all leaders. Okay? The same way with some of you here. I've got this set up, and I've talked to Pastor LeVay about this a little bit. The class, sometime like Sunday afternoon, after you've had some lunch or something, to come back and be in a class. And it's going to take 4 or 5 weeks to bring you into that exceeding grace. God's ready to do that. I said, God's ready for that to happen. God's ready for that exceeding grace to happen. Hello. And thanks be to God for the unspeakable gift. You know, he's talking about his son. He's talking about, through Christ, we're the ones that are going to do that work with him. Now go to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. And you'll see it another way. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. For it was fitting for him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect who suffer. Well, who do you suffer for? He suffers for us. But there was a joy set before him. See, the sons of glory, bringing many sons to glory, bringing many sons into the glory of Almighty God. That was what Jesus could see while he was going to the cross. Can you see yourself using the exceeding grace of God, which is already yours? Oh, yeah, I'm going to show you that too. Okay. There's always one more scripture in there. And I'm not going to be sorry about it. If you just go over into Psalm 112, praise the Lord, blessed is the man that fears the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his command. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. Now stop there a minute. You got children? This is not talking about you, this is talking about your seed. You got children, your seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. The generation of the righteous shall be blessed. The generation of the righteous shall be blessed. That's talking about you. Have some of you have children and you've been planting seed. You've been putting seed out there. Who are you planting for? Not just for you, you're planting for them. You're also planting for other people. You're also planting for other ministries. Come on, just think about what you've been doing. And you know, this is a healthier balance. Psalm 112, you should memorize it. The whole psalm. You shouldn't just read it one time. You should stay in it till you know it. Why? Because it's the wealth of the sinner laid up for the just. It's the wealth of what God made righteous that's going to keep coming to your life forever. You can't walk away from God. You can't walk away from his word. You can't walk away from seeking him. And you can't give up on yourself. Now, verse 3, wealth and riches shall be in his house. Well, let's talk about your house. If wealth and riches is there, so is righteousness. So is holiness. So is the love of God. If you're the only one that's born again in your household, then your whole household is covered by what's in you.
Amen.
Come on, you know that's true.
Amen.
All I'm doing is elaborating on these things. They're already yours. Okay? His righteousness endures forever. Well, we just read that someplace else. It's just a little while ago. Unto the upright, verse 4, there arises light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. Verse 5, a good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Who's a good man? Is not good but God. So it's God's goodness work in you to bring about the exceeding grace that's in you. Surely, verse 6 of Psalm 112, surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. So then I won't forget you forever. Now look at verse 7. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. Well, wait a minute. We run away from God when something goes wrong instead of running to Him. We run away from Him when we do something that's wrong. How can I approach God? How can I go back to Him? He says, that's what you got to do. You got to come to me first. You got to come to me last. You got to come to me in between. You got to come to me no matter what. I'll take care of it. I'm almost done. Verse 7. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed. Is your heart fixed? Is it fixed on God?
Yeah.
Is it 24/7 fixed on God? Hello? And it doesn't matter what kind of trouble you're going through. He's going to pull you through it. He's going to make it right. He's not going to let you die until He's done with you.
Amen.
Trusting in the Lord. His heart is fixed. Trusting in the Lord. Every night when I pray Psalm 91, it has two different places in there where it talks about trusting God. And I will stop Psalm 91 and just say, I'm trusting in the Lord with all my heart. I lean not to my own understanding. In all my ways I acknowledge Him, and You will direct my path. And Your Word and Your Spirit is going to be my truth. And then I'll go on with Psalm 91. But His heart is established, verse 8. Have you asked God to establish you? That's not going to get done in 10 minutes. That's going to get done in time. But establish me, Lord. He shall not be afraid. See, both of these dealing with fear. Until he sees his desire upon his enemies. Well, you know what I think that is? That's Revelation chapter 19. When you're coming back to the earth with the Master, and you see your desires and your enemies. That's why. Because you're walking behind the Master, and He's on a white horse, and you're on a white horse, and you're all dressed in white. You're all dressed in bright, really, I think, what it should be. Because you're getting the light from Him. And nothing's going to happen to you when you come back to the earth, except you're going to have to share your experiences with God. That's what people are going to be looking for. How was it when Satan was here? Was it really hard on you? Because those people are not going to know. Your the heart is fixed, your heart is established. Now, verse 9 is the same thing that I read to you in verse 9 of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. He has dispersed, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. Your horn is your authority. And what he's saying to you is that God will elevate your authority to such a place that it brings honor to you. Now, verse 10, the wicked shall see it and be grieved. Why is it going to grieve the wicked? Because we're going to be doing what they wanted. And we're going to be elevated, and they're going to be put down. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. His desire of the wicked shall perish. The desire of the wicked shall perish, and he will perish with it, unless you can turn to Christ. Now, you know what I have at the end of this message? It's time for us to stand up for Jesus. It's time for us to be doing these things. There's a lot of other scriptures I didn't get to use, but God will supply all of your need from his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. God will take care of you, inside, outside, doesn't matter. He will take care of everything, and he's never late. He will always supply on time and never be late. Come on, stand up with me now. You're going to remember Psalm 112? You're going to learn it? Can you say with me, my checkbook is not empty?
My checkbook is not empty.
Here's your checkbook. Right here. Your spirit. What's the Holy Spirit saying to you right now? Just close your eyes. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of your church. Thank you, Lord. From the oldest to the youngest, you're taking care of us. You're developing us to be all that you want us to be. And you're having your way with us today.